I'd like to know my audience. How many birders? Would you really like bird watcher slash birder? Okay. All right. That's good to know. Very early on, I got it. Well, I'll tell you a little bit, tiny bit about myself. I'm from Texarkana, about 8 blocks from the Texas side, so and on the Arkansas side. So go easy on me. I've also violated the first rule that I learned really early on. Is like throw a lot of beautiful pictures of birds in there, and I just had pretty graphs. I had a lot of pretty graphs, and so I'm apologizing and starting off, -2. Anyway, just quickly tell you about our organization. If you're not a member, consider joining us. You know, we do field trips too. We have a lot of benefits for our members and speaker series, all kinds of fun stuff. We were established back in 1969, mostly to help take care of this property in West Houston, the Edith Elmore Nature Sanctuary, and to get some bird watchers together to start doing some advocacy and conservation work. We are a chapter of National Audubon. We've got about 5,000 National Audubon members, about 1,000 chapter-only members, which are much more helpful for us, and 15 staff, about, just depends on the month. And we also have a allied group, the Houston Audubon Docent Guild, which helps us. These are our sanctuaries, just here at Houston Audubon. We've got this one little, here's our headquarters over here, but really our big critical properties are down on the coast. We are a land trust. So, like the Katy Prairie Conservancy, we own and manage a lot of land. Updated that number with a couple more acquisitions last year. Do quite a bit of advocacy, a little bit of research, often in collaboration, and quite a bit of monitoring on our properties and elsewhere in the region. In addition to conservation, we're also big on education. We have 2 nature centers. We reach a lot of folks from K to Gray. Our big, is that new for you?
You just totally acquired that.
All right. Our big strength, and I don't just say this because I have to, is our volunteers. We depend greatly. We have a staff of 15, and we have volunteers that are legion, and help us when we need help to get things done. So that's really our strength. We are a grassroots conservation group. Totally lifted this from Texas Monthly when this story came out about Houston, but anyway, I liked it as a title slide. My job up here today in this 2-part talk is to give you the big picture. I'm an ornithologist. I serve on committees that look at what are the priorities and help set the priorities for bird conservation. Who needs to be in, who needs to be out? And of course, everything needs to be in, but it's always, you have to draw the line, like what are we gonna focus on? So I want to give you my take on what's behind a lot of the priorities when you hear, well, we need to protect these species. I'm gonna walk you through a little bit of why we need to protect X and Y species, and then I'll hand it over and we'll scale that down to Houston and give you some actions to help us move forward a little bit. Okay, I'm gonna blow past this outline and just tell you, I'll talk about it in our current challenges of climate change and our human footprint, talk about the bigger picture of bird conservation, and very quickly, what our next steps are. All right. Climate change, probably now you guys look like I'm preaching to the choir a little bit, but to recap, if you've been off on sabbatical for 20 years, here in Houston, we're almost in a little bit of a Goldilocks zone. Some places are really have dire predictions for the next 40 years, and some places are going to be really wet, some places are going to be really dry, and our predictions are actually pretty moderate, I'll get more into that, and then we'll talk about human population. I like this, it's aged well. This is one of the Hadley models. The hotter regions are areas by 2070 to 2100. If they're red, that's how many degrees they will be warmer if predicted. And I believe this is using the moderate, slightly below business as usual predictions. So what that means is, so places like Houston, we're looking at, you know, at four. So I know we're right at two, we're trying to keep things under 2 degrees change, but it's, right now we're still on course for four. I like this to show you that, all right, I'll come over here. We're right here. All I need you to take away from this is ice volume down here. These are two different models that show how temperature has changed through geologic time, specifically thousands of years going back that way. What you need to see is this peak and this peak. These are in line with the ice, and these two are, you know, these are supporting each other. Basically, you see the same shape going over there. And what this is 125,000 years since it's been this warm. And it's getting warmer. Here's another, just, you know, you want to see that data, you want to be comfortable with it. These are all the different models. So this is not just one little group in some office working on this stuff. These people are all competing to be more precise. There are a lot of models, and they're all showing the same pattern. If they're, you know, everybody's kind of hoping old NCAR SISM down here is going to be the right model, as it's a little more conservative, but chances are it's going to be somewhere in the middle. For precipitation, it's about 20% reduction of precipitation for our region by, I believe this is by 2100. And it also breaks it out by season. So what you see in the, you know, winter, there's about 20% reduction in precipitation. Spring, it's actually a little less as well. Fall, actually, bottom right, it's actually going to, you know, have the least amount of change if this all pans out. And these are pretty good. These are pretty good, well supported models. It's going to be drier. It's going to be warmer. One, I've read a couple of popular books on climate change, and this was a point that really, it clicked, and I'm like, I get it. And the take home is, and I'll quickly walk through this, but the take home is climate change, as it's seen in all of these proxy data sets that scientists are working on, it's not a dial. You know, it's not something that's just gonna inch up. What's happening is it's gonna inch up, and then it's gonna be like a switch. It just flips, and that's called the tipping point. We've heard about these different tipping points, feedbacks that get kicked in at a certain point. All those different feedback loops are what feed into this tipping point. So, you know, right now we're dealing with this existing, this is all of our biodiversity as we know it. And you can take out all the megadiversity that we wiped out when we came across the Bering Strait. That would still be in here, because that's not affected by what we're talking about with this operating space of climate. And so right now we're this blue arrow. We're trying to keep this from, you know, coming down into the switch of a very different world that supports a very different biodiversity. Most likely, well, it would be a very much more depauperate biodiversity. And with that, you lose quite a bit of stability without all those redundancies of functions. So anyway, I wanted to make that point. For us in particular, as things get warmer, as they get drier, we're going to have ecosystem shifts. I think you hit on that a little bit, and what that means is where there once was American Beach, there won't be American Beach anymore, because it's just, there's not enough water, there's not enough freezes. If you're Black Mangrove and you're from the South, this place is awesome right now. 20 years ago, that wasn't the case. You got froze every winter. You could never make a living as a Black Mangrove in Galveston Bay. Go down to the coast and Black Mangroves everywhere. The Black Mangrove Cassidy down in Corpus Christi is now 10 feet tall. It's unprecedented. Plants are slower to move than birds or bats or insects. So there's some problems when your ecological niche has moved because of climate, and the plant, there's a lag of the plants getting to where they need to be. It's very chaotic for ecosystems. Plus there's blockages. We've used all this time and money to set up all these systems, all these parks, and these little patchwork. Well, great, now the patchwork moves, and there's no way for that marsh to migrate to where it needs to be. So now we're trying to design parks so that there are corridors so these habitats can move and track their niche. And that's gonna take a lot of effort to try to help things along. And in some cases, they're gonna be assisted. We'll have to figure out, we're in Houston, it's 10 years from now, maybe we need to be planting tomaleep and thorn scrub if we wanna have healthy systems. And we may have to move some of the things from down there that on the southern edge that aren't doing well. Okay, here's what that looks like projected in these ecosystem shifts for Eastern North America. So this is 60 to 90 average. Each of these cells are different kinds of habitat. Really all I want you to take away from this is 2070 to 2100. Look at this blue, it's gone. A lot of this green has really moved into the foothills of the Appalachians and further up. The red had, this elm, ash, cottonwood, moved way north. Those are really strongly supported, projections that we are planning for as conservation biologists. Sea level rise. I'm the bad cop. Sarah's gonna be the good cop in this. There are some positives, this is real. We're having to deal with this right now, trying to figure out, do we buy this property that's at 3 feet elevation, or should we maybe move inland and buy this property that's at 10 feet elevation? And the reason for that, and that's why the DFD, many other agencies are making these kinds of decisions based on sound science. And where things are right now is, we're looking at, that's feet. So anywhere by 2050, half a foot to up to 2 feet elevation by 2050. That's a big change on the coast for us. And that's gonna have some pretty serious ramifications. Again, well-supported stuff. Can't talk about sea level rise without talking about the Ike Dyke. Boom. We all kind of laughed about, a year ago? 2 years ago? We were like, that'll never happen. It's too expensive. No one wants to pay for that. What is it, $5 billion? $6 billion, which means it probably ended up being more like $12 billion. But it's getting a lot of support. We're now at the point where our organization and a lot of organizations around are having to decide, we're going to have to choose A, B, or C option. And so you should know that that's happening and all the ramifications of the actions of if they put this giant wall in, what we're going to do. All right.
Can you go back one?
Sure.
And tell us where, go back to the seawall and tell us where the Bolivar,
your
preserve is, by the way.
Yeah. That's Bolivar Flats, that's Horseshoe Marsh, that's Mundy Marsh up there, and right where it turns in would go right through, it would be on the west of High Island, which is right, you can see the highway, the white line goes up there. Here's East Beach. This is critically important global shorebird habitat. There's some really good stuff.
That also may affect some of the bird islands too.
Oh yeah, here's North Deer, here's Evia right there. This is not a done deal. They're talking about, what are the best options, and lines are being proposed, coalitions are being built and dissolved, and it's all in discussion. As conservationists, we would rather figure out where we want to be, and what's our position if this thing moves forward. We don't want to be flat-footed. People. Nobody likes to talk about overpopulation or population, period. But just know we're at 7 billion people by 2023. We're looking about end of the century, 10 billion people. That's a lot of people. And on top of that, maybe that's just in those other continents. Now, Latin America and North America, South America, Central America, pretty good growth. Definitely growth in both. It would be fantastic if we could all decide to have an education for everybody and have neutral population growth and start pushing it down, everything could recover. But that's not what UN or anyone else is saying, so we have to plan for that as well. We're in the middle of the sixth mass extinction. It's pretty dire. And birds and mammals and everything else, we're having to not just focus on a few extinct, endangered or threatened species. We're now looking at common species and trying to focus there before they become, endangered, because most everything is in decline. So we're really trying to get ahead. Wow. Okay. 5 minutes. Nature conservation. All right. Old Teddy Roosevelt. Love it. Out on a bird island. His take home here is there's a lot more to it than utility of what we can get out of nature. And specifically, wildlife has intrinsic value. Nature has intrinsic value. They're part of our natural heritage, in addition to the extrinsic value that we so often have to use in making our arguments for their value, whether it's the ecological services, birding, the nature tourism, or even hunting, which is a big driver. I often like to think about and talk about how conservation and human motivation, how do you get people to do things? Often these messages are targeted to people that on Maslow's pyramid is we're way up here I'm comfortable, everything's taken care of. Now come on out and let's get some conservation done. However, we're often targeting all of these messages to communities that they don't have the ability to make those kinds of decisions. Oh, you want me to stop fishing because there's too much shrimp fishing? Well, we've got to really think about solutions that are at the broad spectrum, all up and down, if we're going to get this to work. All right, conservation approaches, just to let you know how we do things. 3 R's, we've got lots of regions. Birds are very well developed. So you guys like birds? Not everybody does. They think birders are kind of weird. And they are, but that's okay. Bird people are not necessarily just crazy for birds. It just so happens that they're really good for doing conservation work because they've been studied so well for so long. So they're often these, old term umbrella species that if you can focus on the birds, we've got big ranges, everything, a lot of other stuff is going to be conserved. So the 3 R's, reservation, restoration, reconciliation. These are the BCRs. Wouldn't it be great if states look like that, that were a little more ecologically driven, but these are bird conservation regions. This is how bird conservation, this is how we organize. We know ourselves as 37, you're in 37. So own it. there's even breakdown, yeah, Cassie.
Is that an Audubon designation?
No, that's everybody. Agencies, okay. State agencies, all the nonprofits are all, we all, talk in bird conservation regions.
Is that based on the assemblage of birds?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's habitat. We organize ourselves with all stakeholders in these initiative teams. Our priorities, we've got marine, beach, coastal, marsh, prairie, and forest. And we specifically target species and acres of habitat to get it done. Reservation is good stuff. Restoration could use a little help. And then there's reconciliation, which Sarah will talk about, and that is where human-dominated landscapes, where there's still wildlife here. Nature doesn't end at the city limit. We'll skip that. These actions that are needed, certainly down to a minute by now. We're talking about what needs to be 2 minutes. Great. Slow it down. Public. So. To get conservation done, there have to be policies so that we have a level playing field for everyone that's operating within communities and society. Private industry has a huge role. If you know the work of the Wildlife Habitat Council, they help us, to engage with private industry to help them be a part of the solution. And of course, people, everything, you guys are here. Thank you for being here and caring. You're the people that are going to help us get through. So there's this big plan, and one the take-home message is 1/3 of all bird species they need urgent conservation action. This is the 2016 plan that all the bird people work on, and it's pretty bad. These are the major habitats. You know, we are coastal prairie. I know it's a lot more complicated, but for organization purposes, this is how we do it. Specifically, coast, 37% of the species are on the watch list, in trouble. Grasslands, 27%, and wetlands, 19%. I want to skip ahead. Well, grasslands, I'm going to take two of her, I'm going to take one of her minutes. And grassland birds, happens every time. Grassland birds, because KPC put this together. It's bad for prairies. The work that KPC does and anyone else working on prairie is critically important. It's hard to understand that because you're here on the coast, eh, prairie, I hear about it all the time. It's bad, and all of those birds in red are breeding in the areas in blue, wintering in the areas in blue, and we are very, very important for wintering birds and breeding birds as well. And there's just not much habitat. I'm sure if you've been to any of Jaime's programs, you know, you've heard it, and it's true, and the birds are driving that pattern like crazy. It's, you know, we need more prairie. Coastal birds, shorebirds are down nearly 70% in many cases. All these lines are showing just semi-palmated and western sandpipers, a few birds passing through. You can see they're relying on those red dots, which are critically important places. Wetland birds, this is the good news. Great return on investment. We've been working on wetlands for more than 50 years through duck stamps, waterfowl. People have really stepped up, and the work has paid off. So it's an excellent example. If we can do with what we've done with wetlands, we've turned it around with these other habitats, then it can be done. What about Houston? Conserve and restore these wetlands, prairies, and stopover habitat. Specifically here in town, there's a lot of woodlands and wetlands, and even some prairies, pocket prairies. But some of that serves good purpose. From here. We'll do all of those, all of these actions, but what's really important is that we measure what we did, we monitor what we do, and we inform our process so that we are learning from it and we're sharing what we're learning, and we're not just doing something to be moving around and moving chairs around on the Titanic. It's important that, you know, we know that we're moving in the right direction, and you can't do that without monitoring. So if you're out doing citizen science, You're part of the solution to help us inform our metrics for those management decisions. Adjust, repeat, save the world. also, nurture that culture of conservation, which you're here, but we have to do more programming. If you can't make people aware of nature, if you can't make them appreciate nature, then they will not care about nature, and they will not act and advocate for nature. We're moved into towns from the cities. Not everybody's growing up in the woods like many of us did with some time, you know, out in the woods, and we're moving away from it. So we really have to instill that. You're up. Sorry, that was a whirlwind, y'all.
There's some water back there.
I thought that was great.
That was fantastic.
Thanks, Richard. Okay, my name is Sarah Flournoy. I'm also with Houston Audubon, and I'm the program manager for Bird Friendly Communities. And so let's just start talking about our resident and migrating birds, the birds of Houston. On the left, we have a red-shouldered hawk, one of our resident birds. It nests here. We have a ruby-throated hummingbird. We have a hooded warbler. Hooded warbler is one of my favorite birds. It is one of the first birds to hear and see in the spring. It skulks on the ground. You know, you find it down low on leaf litter. And then a downy woodpecker, which many of y'all have probably seen, and it's the little woodpecker on trees. Yesterday I was on a walk and I was thinking about saving Planet Houston and what should we as Houstonians, what's the most important thing we should do to help birds in Houston? What's the most important thing? And I started thinking, is it creating more habitat along the bios so we can have those corridors of wildlife habitat, people can connect to them on trails? Is it transforming our horticultural industry so that instead of offering invasive plants into our neighborhoods and developments. We have native plants that aren't treated with pesticides as an alternative. Is it making sure that every classroom teaches about biology, wildlife, and birds? And I realize there's a lot we can do, and I think we need to do all of it. We need to work toward that. I would just challenge each of you to think of one thing you could do. And Richard mentioned motivation. And I was even thinking about bringing like little cards and having you all write down just for yourselves, like what's one thing I could do to help birds. I didn't do that, but as I'm going through the presentation, maybe you can think about that and then think about, so what would motivate you? And I think it's just finding the right fit for your style and your personality of one thing you could do. I know some people here are working with local parks. Some people are working in their neighborhoods just to get their neighbors excited about birds. And some people will take their kids or grandkids out birding to see a bird and notice a bird for the first time. Just there's so much we can do. National Audubon, this is Bird Friendly Communities as part of National Audubon. We're doing this around the country, and the motto is where birds thrive, people prosper, because it's about bringing the urban populations, connecting the urban populations with birds. Richard really hammered in some challenges, so here are some images to reinforce our urban challenges of sprawl, congestion, traffic, pollution, air pollution, and water pollution, water being so important for birds. This is a neat map just showing our urban density, housing density. So here you have in 1940, the red areas are the most dense areas. 1950, 1960, 1970, 80, 90, 2000, 2010. And then this is a projection for 2030, but you start to really think about birds, resident and migrating birds, like where are they going? I mean, where are they landing? Where are they resting? Where are they feeding in these human-dominated landscapes? This is what those human-dominated landscapes look like frequently. You've got subdivisions that are primarily lawn and roads. You have an ethic. This is an ad from, it's an old ad from Home Depot, but it says in the fine print, it's Mother Nature versus you. And I think that's just this ethic that it amuses me that I think we need to be inspired by Mother Nature and work with Mother Nature, not preparing for battle against Mother Nature. The lower left corner is it's my parents' next door neighbors, and I've always thought their house is really pretty, but it's just dominated by lawn, and that is a very resource intensive to have. It requires a lot of fertilizers and pesticides and other chemicals that really are harming the system more than we fully realize. What's happening in the soil, what's happening when your kids run on that lawn or your pets run on that lawn. I think that's something that we need to start facing. And then this guy in his hazmat suit treating the lawn is a symbol of that. So we're trying to, with Bird Friendly Communities, put a positive spin on how we can address this. And there's four key areas. These four key areas you can do on any scale. So you can do it in your patio, or you can do it across all of Houston in big parks. And that's the first one is provide native plants for birds. Get to know which plants are going to help your birds the most by providing food. Create inviting habitats. So you can add supplementary feeders or nest boxes. You can plant your plants in a way that will encourage nesting and protection. Water features, providing fresh water for birds. Three, limit dangerous threats, including cats, pesticides, window strikes. And then four, get connected with others. So be inspired by others. When you go visit your local nursery, ask, you know, what kind of native plants are important for birds and other wildlife. raise the next generation to recognize and appreciate wildlife. So we'll just go through these. This group may be somewhat sophisticated, so you already get this concept, but it's worth learning and then sharing with others. And it's why native plants matter to birds. So 98% of our songbirds feed insects to raise their young. So you've got to have insects if you want the new generation of birds. That's very, very important. How do you have the insects? The insects require the native plants that they've been adapted to feed on and grow on. So for example, here's a dogwood. Its host plant is the unicorn caterpillar is host plant is the dogwood. And then this is a picture just to kind of reinforce that, the gray crested flycatcher, some do nest here. They need those caterpillars and other arthropods to feed their young. So there's this relationship of plant, insect, and bird that's very, very important. This is kind of an interesting stat. So a chickadee raises a clutch of, I think, 4 birds. Is that right, Richard? 4 babies? So it's a cavity nester. So imagine a nest of chickadees in a snag of a tree. And the adult chickadee, researchers have monitored this. The adult chickadee will fly out, nonstop, all day to bring caterpillars to its nest. It takes up to 9,000 caterpillars to raise one clutch of chickadees. Those caterpillars are going to be found on the native trees. So if you don't have your native trees, you're not going to have your caterpillars, you're going to have no baby chickadees, you're going to have no chickadees. So that's the relationship. So here's a list of a bird-friendly tree list. This is from Doug Tallamy. Could I see a show of hands of how many of y'all have read or are familiar with Bringing Nature Home? It's kind of the tone, we call it Tallamizing or the Tallamaic vision, because it's really great stuff, but you can start to see that oaks, cherries, plums, willows support 532 species of Lepidoptera, butterflies and moths, 456. And that really rich diversity in offerings. And then you get down to some of our common plants that you see in Houston. Crepe myrtle supports only 3. Golden rain tree supports 1. Nandina supports 0. So when you look at our urban landscapes and they're filled with these plants at the bottom, it's like there's no food for birds.
I was just gonna say, he's supposed to be speaking in the Texas Pollinator Partnership in May.
Okay, and I'm glad to know about the Texas Pollinator Powwow. Thank you. But it's not only insects. So here's a Baltimore, an orchard oriole on a black cherry, a blue jay eating an acorn. And apparently they take the acorns and they save them in the tree bark. You could follow that in your own yard, I guess, if you have a lot of blue jays and monitor them yourself. Ruby-throated hummingbird on a cardinal flower, and a black-throated blue warbler on American beauty bush.
Beautyberry,
sorry. Okay, so creating inviting habitats. One of the most important things you can do is provide water. So this is a blue wing warbler on a water feature, shallow, audible water. Birds like to stand in water to bathe and drink, so a shallow water will be preferable to a deep pond. If you do have a deeper pond, you just want to have a little shallow edge to it or have, you know, rocks in there. This is another example of, I call it a bubbling rock, but I know this homeowner and she has lots of birds. It's a good photography opportunity. And then this was one of our board members just took this the other day. It's an American robin in his bird bath and it's having some sort of good time. And then don't forget that we do have our natural water, like our bio corridors, where you can see birds. I mean, almost every time I walk along Braids Bio, I see birds. We need to keep those water sources clean. You can also provide supplementary feeding. Native plants, number one, but try a feeder. It's enjoyable. If you wonder what kind of seed to use, black sunflower seed is a good go-to. And then Audubon also sells bird seed at, I think they have a deal, is it Lowe's or Home Depot? One of the big ones National Audubon has a deal with. But I think you can get this at a lot of different feed stores. Hummingbird feeders are lots of fun too. It's just sugar, it's just one part sugar, four parts water. And you want to put your feeders where birds can escape predators. So near a tree or someplace where they can move away if they need to. You can also supplement, so a eastern screech owl, for example, would naturally live in a snag, but because we don't like our snags, we cut them down in our cities, we're worried about security, safety, and things like that. You can do an owl box, or a chickadee box, or a wren box. And this is a really neat website. NestWatch has all about birdhouses. You put in your region, and then you put in your habitat, and it'll give you specific plans for nest boxes, how to, you know, you can design them, how to hang them, you know, how to orient them, how high. It's a neat resource. To create an inviting habitat, you want layers. So you've got your ground cover, your mid-story, and your upper, your overstory. So a bird like a wood thrush, it really needs to be down on the ground. If you want to leave leaves on the bare ground, that is going to bring in those thrush. Often we want to cover a whole ground with grass so the birds have no place to feed. Another way to create inviting habitat is by clumping a species together. So this is crossvine. It's really beautiful. And you can imagine this. This is in an arboretum, I think, in Atlanta. And the hummingbirds just cover it up. It's a real crowd pleaser, and it's real showy. You've got to limit threats. That's our third one. And we just, Houston Audubon just hosted a talk about cats. Pete Mara from the Smithsonian spoke. This is incredible. 2.4 billion birds are killed by cats in the U.S. annually. 2.4 billion birds. It's just, we can't escape it. And it's a hard issue because people love cats. Cats are wonderful. But I think what's happening is it's two things. One, feral cats that have no owner, and two, cats that are allowed to spend time outdoors. So we encourage people to keep cats indoors. There's creative things you can do, like a catio. Have y'all heard of catios? Or you just create a secure outdoor environment for your cat to be in the outdoors, but not hurt wildlife. Another threat's pesticides. So we're real big right now in our community working on monarch conservation as well as bird conservation. I worry about plants that native milkweeds that have been treated with pesticides, and then that's what we're telling people to plant. And is it doing more harm than good? We need to stand up and say, where are these plants that don't have pesticides? Window strikes. What happens in our urban environment is if birds see reflective glass, they think it's the sky or a tree and they run into it. There are methods like tape, but also glass can be angled down. There are solutions to window strikes. And fourth, connect with others. So please, if you have a bird-friendly yard, let people know about it. Share plants, dig them up, give them to your friends. Talk to your local nurseries. We're trying to spread the word about this and build a movement. Okay, so past criteria for our landscapes. If you think about Houston, I'm trying to think what street you could drive down and really see this, but it's almost every single one. It's like Crepe Myrtle, Bradford Pear, Crepe Myrtle, Bradford Pear, Ligustrum, Ligustrum, Ligustrum. People like it because it's evergreen, and it provides some sort of cover from traffic and things like that. I get it, but it's just like, okay, let's do that, plus let's choose landscapes that offer food web value, wildlife appreciation, mental health, watershed value, carbon sequestration. You know, we can do all of this. Resources, birdfriendly houston.org. This is hot off the presses. You're the very first presentation to see this. This, we said we have got to give people real tools so that they can help birds in their communities. And so you can do it in your yard, and you can talk to your homeowners association, your park, your school, so we can collectively make a difference. It has a bird-friendly map. You can get acquainted with common birds in Houston. You can be part of our Bird Friendly Yard program. We have a set of criteria we encourage you to follow. There's a lot here. Take the Bird Friendly Pledge.
Provide feedback.
Provide feedback. Because it's so new, we are looking for, like, what have we missed? What are questions people have? What are resources people need that we can include? Really, any feedback you have is, I'd love to hear it. Here's one page. So this is our native plants for birds page. What we've done is we have little learning boxes. So, you know, let's say you're a total beginner. Well, getting started. This lists all the plants. It gives you links to learn more about bird-friendly plants, and is a place to get started. We have a Houston Audubon's Natives Nursery. I'll tell you a minute about that. Pre-plant gardens, where to buy plants, learn about lawn. There's a rich resource here for y'all to learn about. The other resource I wanted to mention is our Houston Audubon Natives Nursery. We propagate real deal native plants. These are plants that have been collected from very local area. And Flo Hanna and her team of generous volunteers who get together every Friday and bump those up. Those plants have never been treated with pesticides. We sell to the homeowner or individual, and we also work a lot with partners like KPC and others, Houston Parks, to really try to transform the landscape on a bigger scale. We're expanding our nursery. That's exciting news. That's pretty new news too. Mm-hmm. Now for some inspiration, I'm just gonna slide through these slides. There's a woman named Deborah Good. She lives in a neighborhood called Pine Brook near NASA. She realized that she had a prairie pothole in her neighborhood, kind of a real traditional neighborhood development. They were gonna flatten it out and turn it into the community center with a swimming pool and everything, and she said no. And so she contacted Houston Audubon, and we were able to receive donations that we then could, being a nonprofit, we could help her then purchase a sign, trail, do invasive removal, so she could turn this prairie pothole area into something that the neighborhood could enjoy. She does all the landscaping for her entire neighborhood development. And this is just out her window. It's Yopon. Holly covered in cedar wax wings, and she sent that to me, and she was really proud. But to me, she's an example of one person who can make a difference. This used to be a sandbox. This is in Pine Brook too, and it was all, she said it was kind of getting kind of gross. She turned it into a pollinator garden. And then Bob Honig, who some of y'all might know, he shared this quote with me, a tip: make your plantings look intended rather than untended. And the way this is done here is with thoughtfully designed how high the plants grow, the taller plants go in the middle, and then it does have a nice edge around it, a cement edge around it. Keeps things contained. This is right here, right out here in the Arboretum. The Arboretum is doing significant restoration work. The Arboretum has, they do have Chinese privet, but a lot of cherry laurel, a lot of yopon that was just taking over. This is creating this very dense thicket. So they have created this beautiful savanna woodland by clearing out a lot of that thicket, and they're doing all sorts of experimentation, and they are, I'm most impressed with the fact that they are doing experimentation plots that I think can inform the restoration we continue to do in Houston. This is Mandel Park Prairie Garden. These are all real deal native plants. This is a prairie portion of a community vegetable garden space, if y'all have ever been to Mandel. And it's at the corner of Richmond and Mandel. And it was designed like a traditional landscape. So you can see the, you know, trying to design for color and height. And it's now going through a revolution. Two books that you might want to read, Planting in a Post-Wild World, Planting in a Post-Wild World, and Garden Revolution. These are going to challenge our ways of thinking about our own landscapes. And you can get inspired by visiting a place like this. Garden Revolution. Lawn. I mentioned lawn before. Very resource intensive, not very interesting, doesn't connect you to the seasons. Start small. This person just said, I'm going to start small. I'm going to plant a few, cut out a little bit of my lawn and plant a few different native plants. This person loves wildflowers. They've clumped the wildflowers, they've grouped the black-eyed Susan and the wine cups together for impact. And you can imagine how happy you'd feel coming home from work and being able to see this. It takes time and you have to manage expectations doing habitat work. So this is at High Island. If y'all go to High Island this spring, I need to go see how this is doing. We call this the barnyard. But it was an old home, just degraded land. And we said, well, what are we gonna do? Well, we went in, I mean, literally, we kind of raked it. We had some native seeds that we put down that we got from our nursery. And we've slowly been monitoring it. We've had to manage expectations so that people know it's not gonna be like this perfect thing the first year. Things take time to develop and establish. There are certain species that are gonna be the first ones that show up, like black-eyed Susan. And then every year is gonna be a surprise after that. This homeowner has a shady yard. This is a challenge. We have a lot of prairie plants here, but what are you supposed to do if you have a shady environment? Well, this homeowner decided I'm not gonna have lawn and do crushed granite. And I'm gonna focus on the native trees, like river birch, and I think it's a swamp chestnut oak. She does have non-native plants because she just said she has to have kind of a sense of order, but could still add native trees. Oh, this is a great one. This is a homeowner in Bel Air. She and her husband designed this curvilinear backyard. This was, I mean, very shortly after they installed plants. And this was after, I think, maybe a year, maybe under a year. What's neat about this yard is she overlooks a ditch in Bel Air. Unfortunately, the ditch is full of golden rain trees and other invasive trees that spread along our waterways and corridors. But I'm hoping her work will spread to the common areas. Another inspiration for me, that's Jaime, by the way, in the lower right corner, is the MD Anderson Prairie. I think, you know, prairies connect you to your natural heritage, and it's neat that it's on a scale that's big enough that it's a little bit more manageable to maintain. This is also a place where people, okay, I'll tell you this, let's see. There have been studies done where there's people with a similar illness are in a hospital room recovering. One person in the hospital room is able to look out over a natural landscape. The other has a wall or whatever this study showed, doesn't look out onto anything. The research has shown that the room of the person recovering that's looking out over the natural landscape will recover more quickly. Nature is very much connected to our health, our mental health, our physical health, our happiness. Even so much so that when you look at a picture on the wall of nature, your blood pressure lowers. So having this, I get goosebumps because having this prairie at MD Anderson for the people who are recovering from cancer and those who are taking care of people with cancer, it's a very powerful thing. We are working on reconciliation of how to deal with our urban or human-dominated landscapes, but we've also got to work on preserving places like this. This is very close into town. This is all Texas coneflower, endemic to this area, and doesn't show up anywhere else. And this was taken last year. So how are we managing places like our power line corridors? How are we making sure that places that are the natural system that haven't been degraded by humans very much, how are we making sure those stay intact? And finally, just a few people that are doing good work, like this lady, Teresa, who has a small patio, but is still doing her part. And Steve, who's been gardening for birds since 1995 with 75% of his yard in native plants. Or Dan, who has 70% of his yard in native plants. And I'll close with a cardinal. We gotta keep our common birds common. A cardinal is a wonderful bird because you can hear it and see it easily. Children can see a cardinal, recognize a cardinal. And I like the idea, I was talking with someone yesterday, just about celebrating our common birds, our cardinals, our blue jays, our wrens. You know, it's not always about these special species. We gotta make sure we celebrate our common urban birds and do things to help them. That closes up my piece. Thank y'all very much. And remember, you gotta choose one thing, commit to one thing you can do. And push yourselves, and I'll try to do it too, because I need to do more. So thanks.